Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Rose Rivers, written by Jacqueline Wilson and read by Eilidh Beaton. To Kate and Nash of Much Ado Books. Chapter 1. I have a little present for you, Rose, said Papa. He handed me a rectangular package tied with string that looked promisingly like a book. I love reading more than anything else, especially the books in Papa's studio. He doesn't know that I borrow them secretly. I don't bother with Mama's books in the cabinet in the drawing room, as they are silly, romantic tosh. I opened my package eagerly, though I feared it would be a Mrs. Molesworth or a Miss Young, the sort of authors considered suitable for a girl of 13. But it wasn't a novel at all, for children or adults. It was a sketchbook, every page blank. I thought this would be a good time for you to start sketching seriously, sweetheart. I know you've been feeling rather mopey since Rupert left for school, said Papa. I didn't know what to say. He was trying so hard to cheer me up, and it's not as if I don't like drawing. I've spent half my childhood drawing witches and dragons and mermaids and tigers and goblins. Goblins are fun because I give them the faces of people I particularly detest. When my brother Algy crayoned all over the pages of my book of Tennyson's poetry, I created an entire community of grotesque goblins with his features. I also like drawing girls. Not pretty girls with long brushed hair and demure dresses. Wild girls who have cut off their curls and tucked up their skirts or borrowed boys' breeches. They climb trees and leap streams and teeter on the very edge of cliffs. Sometimes I draw them being chastised. They're sent away in disgrace. They don't care. Mama always tuts when she sees my drawings. She doesn't approve of them at all. Papa laughs and thinks them funny, but he says that I should start drawing seriously now. He is hoping that I have true artistic ability. It's not just because he's an indulgent father, though he is. He'd like at least one of his children to have inherited his talent. Rupert is the eldest, but has never had the patience or indeed any natural ability at art. I'm his twin, and only 15 minutes younger, so now Papa is pinning his hopes on me. I love your drawings, Rose. They're very lively and amusing, but I think it's time for you to learn to sketch properly. You should draw from life, he said now, unusually serious. Not still life, Papa, I groaned. Our governess, Miss Rayner, sometimes arranges odds and ends that she feels are artistic for us to paint with our shared box of Windsor and Newton watercolours. Last time, she gathered a blue and white striped milk jug from the kitchen, a garish china couple won at a fairground, a bowl of fruit, and a posy of violets in a pink pot. I tried reasonably hard, but the milk jug tilted alarmingly. The china couple looked drunk. The bowl of fruit wouldn't stay circular, and the posy wilted before I could finish it. I know you find still life compositions boring, Rose, but they teach you observation and perspective and shading. They will bring your sketches to life so that they seem realistic representations. I don't care for real life, Papa. I prefer living in my imagination, I said. He laughed at this. He doesn't mind if we argue with him, so long as we do it politely. He actively encourages us to discuss and dispute. I do sympathise, Rose, he chuckled. But sometimes we have to do things we don't care for. I spent my first year at art school copying plaster casts. It was deadly boring, but it taught me a great deal. Then send me to art school, Papa, I said. He laughed again. Perhaps when you're 18 or so, I might send you to Paris to be properly trained. Though I know Mama will object. Mama always objects, I said. In fact, one could say that Mama is objectionable. That's enough, Rose, Papa said firmly. He lets me argue with him, but he will never allow me to criticise Mama. How can I wait 5 whole years anyway? I said instead. Couldn't I go to boarding school where they have a good art teacher? I'd read about girls' boarding schools. I longed to go to one. I imagine charismatic teachers and intelligent girls having lively discussions in classrooms. I saw myself strolling through rose gardens, arm in arm with bookish girls, sipping cocoa together in our nightgowns, confiding secrets. I knew I was wishing for the moon. This was another tired old argument, and one that involved further criticism of Mama. She had no qualms about sending my brother Rupert away to school, but she refused to even consider my education. I have to make do with Miss Rayner in the nursery schoolroom. Sometimes, I find it very hard indeed to like Mama. However, I love Papa, and I will try to learn to sketch properly for his sake. "May I sketch you, Papa?" I asked.
"Certainly, and I will sketch you simultaneously, Rose," he said, very pleased.
It was companionable sitting in Papa's studio. We had a delightful conversation about artists, too. They seemed to live the most interesting and unconventional lives. I would very much like to be an artist, but I don't really like doing art. I tried so hard to do a sketch of Papa, but it was a complete failure. He went lopsided like the milk jug, and I made him look incredibly fierce when he's the most amiable man I've ever met. Not that I've met many men. I sometimes think a nun in a convent has a better social life than me. If only I could go to school. Rupert is so lucky. When I'd finished sketching, Papa wanted to see my portrait, but I wouldn't let him. I didn't want him to see what a failure I was. He's always hopeful that one of us will show artistic talent. He does his best to be encouraging. He praises algae scribbles, even when they're in inappropriate places, like the whitewashed nursery cupboards or the hall skirting board. Papa's praise obviously means a great deal, because he is the painter Edward Rivers, well known in artistic circles. He is a follower of the great Pre-Raphaelite painters, and when he was a young man, he was considered equal to them in talent. He was also wild and bohemian. He even had a pet wombat, just like his hero Rossetti. How I wish he had a wombat now. Our pets are nowhere near as exotic. We have Mistletoe, a large white cat who sleeps all day on his rocking chair by the kitchen range, and Alphonse, Mama's tiny Mexican dog who snaps a great deal and shivers when Mr. Hodgson takes him for his daily walk. Alphonse will be tucked up with Mama on the chaise longue in the drawing room, both of them staring into space with their beady eyes. How strange that it is called the drawing room when no one ever draws there, not even Papa. Now that I'm in my teens and considered a young lady, I'm allowed to sit in the drawing room. Not that I want to. It's not at all comfortable, though the chairs and sofas are cushioned and well sprung. Even Papa seems out of his element there, though he sits dutifully beside Mama for half an hour every day, resolutely keeping her company. Mama suffers from ill health. She's been poorly ever since my youngest sister Phoebe was born and is forever resting. Phoebe is a delightful baby sister, the roundest, rosiest little dumpling. She has such a sunny nature, all chuckles and smiles. By contrast, Mama looks pale and unappetizing nowadays, like cook's vanilla shape. She's grown much fatter since Phoebe and has had to order a dozen new gowns, though I'm sure she could simply have had her old ones altered. Mama cares terribly about clothes. It irritates her enormously that I don't give a fig about my appearance.
"You dress like a hoyden, Rose. How could you wander around barefoot like a ragamuffin off the streets? Have you even brushed your hair this morning?"
"Stop frowning at me like that. Your forehead creases in such an ugly fashion."
"It's because you always have your head in a book. You will end up having to wear spectacles like a frumpy old spinster."
I rather fancy wearing spectacles. I think they might make me look scholarly. I cannot see why being a spinster is so scorned anyway. Miss Rayner is a spinster, and she seems perfectly content, humming hymns and sucking fruit drops and tapping her foot merrily when the little ones pipe on their penny whistles.
She doesn't appear to mind that she only has 3 frocks, and they're all patched and darned, even her best black silk. She seems a happy soul. Mama is the lady of the house, and has a distinguished artist husband and 7 children, and a beautiful home in London, and a wardrobe full of new gowns. And yet she's as miserable as sin. She makes everyone else miserable too, even Papa, though he tries to ignore her complaints.
For pity's sake, Edward, I wish you'd stop doing these sordid urban sketches. Who on earth wants to see pallid drawings of street children? I wish you'd never agreed to do the illustrations for Sarah Smith's wretched little books. I know she does charity work for destitute girls, but I really don't see why you have to be involved.
Why don't you do proper oil paintings again?
I don't feel inclined,
Papa said stiffly.
Because you've lost your famous muse, said Mama with an edge to her voice.
Papa used to do portraits of the Honourable Louisa Mayhorn. His most famous is the one where she's wearing a low-cut evening dress with 1 black strap slipping off her pearly shoulder. It caused a scandal, but everyone agreed that it was a wonderful painting. Perhaps Louisa didn't care for the attention because she doesn't pose for Papa anymore. I wish she did. She always winked at me and called me chicky, and once gave me a little box of rose creams.
Why won't you take on respectable commissions for portraits? If you're tired of London society, perhaps you should try in Scotland. You know very well that my father would be delighted to introduce you to the members of the Caledonian Club.
Mama needled him.
I'm afraid I'm not inspired by whiskery old gentlemen with bulging waistcoats and tartan trews,
Papa said.
I dare say those waistcoats are bulging with purses of gold coins,
Mama responded tartly.
It would be a great help if you care to contribute to the household finances.
Poor Papa. That is the trouble. He really is poor. He makes very little money from his art, especially nowadays. We live in the Lion House, one of the grandest houses in Kensington, but it's actually Mama's, not his. Well, Mama didn't contribute the money herself. She's never done a stroke of work in her life. But my grandparents are very rich. They disapproved of my father, but when it became plain that Mama was determined to marry him, they couldn't bear the thought of their only child living in some ramshackle artist garret. They gritted their teeth and provided the couple with a house. Then Rupert and I were born, and the grandparents were delighted, in spite of everything. They were especially pleased to have a grandson to inherit their business. We travel up to their huge country house near Dundee every New Year's Eve. They call it Hogmanay, and it's a very grand occasion, with dinner and dancing and drinking, a great deal of drinking. When 12 o'clock strikes, Grandpapa sets off fireworks in the garden. We wake up and watch from our bedroom windows, though Sebastian puts his hands over his ears and poor Beth cowers in her bed. Last year, Rupert was allowed to stay up and help Grandpapa light the fireworks. I am exactly the same age, bar 15 minutes, but I'm not allowed anywhere near a match. Grandpapa quotes the poem about Pauline from that silly nursery book, Struwwelpeter. He relishes reciting.
Her apron burns, her arms, her hair, she burns all over, everywhere.
Grandmama frowns and wags her finger in warning. She is even stricter than Mama. Grandmama always looks as if she is sucking a lemon. She smells of citrus too, because she douses herself liberally in lemon verbena. Rupert and I have a theory about this. Grandpapa likes to behave like landed gentry, but he's actually made his money from trade. He owns the biggest jute mill in Dundee. We were once taken there as a special treat. The mill was quite extraordinary. It was the noisiest place in the entire world, with the machines setting up such a clatter that everyone has to gesture. Proper conversation quite impossible. But it wasn't the noise that was most memorable. It was the smell. Jute is a plant grown in India. We have many plants in our back garden, and some of them smell, but sweetly, especially the honeysuckle and jasmine.
I don't know what jute smells like in its native state. Neither does Miss Rayner, because she's not very well informed, even though she's a governess. But when jute's being manufactured for sacks and carpet backing, it smells utterly disgusting. It's a sour, rancid, cloying smell, so astonishingly strong that a full day after our visit to the mill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.